listening to the DFS On Deck podcast, brought to you by Linestar, the top-rated DFS tool set and number one companion for DraftKings, FanDuel, and Yahoo Daily Fantasy. Go Linestar Premium now at linestarapp.com. Now, here are your hosts, fantasy baseball experts Joe Pisapia and Chris Meaney.
Hey, yo, what's up, everybody? It's me, Joey P, Joe Pisapia, and welcome to the On Deck MLB DFS podcast right here on the Linestar app. It is me, it is Chris Meaney, and it's you, and it's the weekend, baby, where we like to take you through Saturday, Sunday, give you our opinions, the stacks, the pitching matchups, the things you need to know, all in a nice little 30 minutes or so, so you can go out and still get to junior soccer games or still get to the daughter's dance recital and still have all your lineups all ready to rock and roll. Or junior's dance recital or your daughter's soccer games or basketball or softball. Whatever's going on right now, that's the kind of world we're living in. We're living in a world where Martin Perez is useful. And we're living in a world now where we've got to change the way we think about things. And we're hoping to do that right here on the Linestar app. So make sure if you haven't already, you go over to linestarapp.com, get that Linestar app installed, and you upgrade to the premium product because it is simply the best thing out there in daily fantasy. It's easy to say because it's true. I mean,
it really is. I love it. It's not expensive. It's cost affordable. And, you know, I go back to the game logs, the fact that it's just easy to see the price changes from day to day, and it gives you a nice sample size, what they've done, if they've hit value, if they continue to return value, if, you know, they're a fade because of the price, the game log, it's just really, it's easy on the eyes. And that's what that, I like all the colors. I like stats. I like numbers. And I just want things to be easy. And that's exactly what it is. And they've been
killing it this year. Because I think sometimes with some of the analytic websites, it's a little too dense.
Confusing.
Yeah. It's difficult to figure out what information you need to have or how to kind of sparse it out. But that's not the case on Linestar app at all. And I really, you know, I know it sounds dumb, but like I like it in a very simple format where I could see it right in front of me and I know exactly what I'm looking at and why. And it's very helpful. And look,
the dashboard thing, Joe, is one of the coolest features I've ever seen. And if you guys haven't had a chance to check it out, you just go.
We sound like an infomercial, but this is actually me honest.
This is us being honest, talking baseball and talking tools. Like really, I wouldn't say it if I didn't believe it. Yeah, I look at the dashboard tool, and I see right away it gives you all the games. It gives you the odds, both odds, the favorite and the dog. It gives you the total. It goes through the lineup. It tells you the price of them and what they've been doing, and then even just an hourly weather thing, like, and it tells you from 5 to 6 this is where the wind's blowing, this is where the wind is going to go from 7 to 9 during the game, if it goes later on in extras, this potential rain, like it just everything that you want is right there. It is easy to look at, and off the top there's like an at glance just your perfect lineup from the last 30 days, salary changes in pitchers and bats, and hot and cold players. Like it's all right there where you don't have to do any research or any digging. It's right in front of you.
Yes. That's what you need, man. It pays for itself. That's what she's all about. All right, let's get on it. And let's go to Saturday. And we've got Tanaka Snell 2.0. This is the sequel to last weekend's matchup there when we had the same game I feel like we were talking about. But all those rainouts kept Tanaka on the schedule to pitch again at a certain time. It was crazy. So this is 2.0 here. I'll still take the Snell side of this one.
Yeah, you lit him up last time, 12K.
Yeah, I'm going to still stay with that one. Are you with me on that?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, all Snell right. He's unreal. And all I'm right, not so crazy about this Yankees lineup.
No, me neither. And I'm going to return our keys on that one. Giolito I do like, too, in the 2 o'clock game against the Blue Jays as well. Giolito has pitched much better. And if he, indeed, the velocity has been upticked, that's great. That Jays lineup still a little suspect to me. So Giolito also very much in play. Not so much Hudson Chavez, not so much Senzatella, and Nola, who, you know, we keep waiting for Nola to turn it around. And you made a great point right before we started to record the show, which is, man, the guy just doesn't catch a break in terms of you know, he just doesn't like. Where is his matchup against the Tigers or the Marlins?
Yeah, you're right. He started at Atlanta, Washington, Washington Mets in Colorado. He did have back to back outings against Miami and Detroit. Obviously, those were his best starts of the season. And then he he went into St. Louis, played Milwaukee. Now he's got Colorado again. So it's been tough. And then after Colorado, he's going to have a start in Chicago. So it hasn't been easy. Don't want to make a lot of excuses for him because he has been walking some guys, but eventually he's going to turn it around. And I wouldn't be surprised if this is the outing actually against Colorado. They've been striking out a ton. They struggled against righties over the past couple of years, so it could be an opportunity, but it's to the point where you definitely can't trust him in cash. It's just a tournament option for those who like to play multiple tournament lineups and you're just looking for an upside pitcher that could potentially be low owned. Like
now on yesterday's show, we talked about taking shots with the Phillies. I think this might be another shot where you could take with the Phillies.
Agree.
It really is out there right now with Senzatella in that ballpark. It's a hitter friendly environment. The cost is going to be right on the Phillies. So keep that in mind. Segura, Hoskins, and Harper, that's your stack there. That's the one you want, I think, that makes you money. If you want to play around with McCutcheon too, that's fine too. But there's opportunity, I think, with Philadelphia because of the fact that if you isolate it into the early slate, and I think that's perfectly fine. You got Steven Matz against Lopez, another one where I kind of just stay away from that game. Walker Buehler, who has pitched better, which is good. It's funny. We want to hammer Walker Buehler, but he's sitting at 4-0. I know it's more indicative of how good the Dodgers have been collectively as an offense. But still, I think everybody, maybe the expectation was just a little too high there.
I think they were through the roof with that guy. Absolutely. And he's turned it around. I mean, he's got two scoreless outings so far this season. He's coming off a scoreless outing against Washington. 7 innings, only gave up 4 hits, struck out 7. So, yeah, he's got 2 bad starts. His first one of the year, let's give him a pass. And then his third one in St. Louis, who, in my opinion, one of the best teams in baseball offensively. They don't strike out at all. They take their walks and make a lot of contacts. So, I am in on Buehler in this start. I'm not impressed with the Reds. I think eventually they'll turn it around, but we're at the quarter mark now, and I've seen a lot of holes in their offense. So I think Buehler can go in and do enough to get the W.
All right, and they got the Indians and Orioles. This one's in Cleveland. Means, who's actually been one of the better pitchers for the Orioles, the ERA is sitting at 2.33. He's been one of the quiet guys. I actually own him in one league where it's just, in a year where everything's just kind of like, oh, the Orioles are stuck, Means has been one of these bright spots here with old Mancini that you kind of go, okay, well, this guy's pretty good. If you're looking for a tournament play, you're going to go up to a bunch of offense. I think Means is that guy where there's a secondary pitcher because Cleveland's not that good. He's facing Plutko making his first start of the season. So I think there's opportunity here. I hardly ever are we going to recommend Baltimore things, but I think Means is one of these I think there's opportunity at the very least. It's cost effective and he's shown you that he can compete. And I think against the Indians, they've shown you that sometimes they don't.
He's got some good numbers too. If you look into them, I mean, the hard hit rate's at 24%. It's one of the best. We're always talking about guys who are up in the high 30s and low 40s that we pick on. And he's got a double digit swinging strike percentage right now at 12.5. And it was 12.1 in the small sample size last year. So you're not wrong. He's been the best pitcher. And people like to call me Means. I may have to get myself an Orioles tee with John Means in the back. If he rakes some guys out on Saturday, I think I might have to do so.
If you win a tournament and you win a ton of money off anything that Chris Meany says, please buy him a Means jersey from Baltimore. Please, that's all we ask for. That's all we want. And yes, we do accept gifts. Last one on the 4 o'clock here in the day slate, the A's and Tigers. Boyd, who I love, kind of wronged me last time. I'm willing to give that a pass. My problem is, again, this Tigers lineup's just so bad. Not that Megden's any good, but I can't get into it. I know Rodriguez has been good. I don't know. This A's lineup has been very good, especially since Olsen got back in. So I'm going to take a pass here on Boyd again. It's not a knock on him. It's just kind of the perfect storm of things that not going in the right direction.
Yeah, that's the key is Olsen comes back, and I think now you're going to start to see this Oakland lineup go because last year they were one of the better offensive teams in baseball. Chapman had that breakout season. Olsen was great. We know about Chris Davis. So I think you're going to start to see it. I mean, they just put up 17 runs the other day. They're playing in Detroit. They're going to beat up on this bullpen all weekend. And, yeah, I like Boyd as well, overall, but there is a little bit of a knock on him, and it's the fly balls. I mean, he's a fly ball pitcher, and that gets him into trouble.
50% especially with power hitters like Davis and Olsen.
Absolutely.
And guys like that. And
that's 27 bombs he allowed last year, Joe, and already five, just recently five.
So in the day slate, we got Snell is obviously the easy cash game pitcher. If you're looking for some tournament plays, Giolito and Means are in there or secondary guys. And if you want to be contrarian, I think Nola's the way to do it or Buehler, one of those two. So you've got a lot of options there. Saturday day slate is actually very exciting. Let's go on to the Saturday evening. You got Corbin Martin making another start here for the Astros against the Red Sox. Tough environment for him. You got Strasburg and Lester. Now, last time, if you recall, on the weekend show last weekend, we had Ryu in Strasburg, and we were all over the Ryu side of this. I'm going to be on the other side. Now I'm going back to Strasburg here. I'm going to go back to the Strasburg side. Even though Lester's pitched very well this year, I think this is an opportunity here against the Cubs at home for Strasburg to have a big game there. And, you know, sometimes the 50-50 I want to run away. This one I want to play, and I want to play Strasburg.
Yeah, well, there's not a lot of options in this later slate. Like, ding, I mean, ding, you ding, go all the way down the option with Berríos, but, you know, other than that, like Bumgarner for sure, I guess. But Arizona has just been so strong against lefties this season. So,
well, yeah, that's I'm glad you said that. That's the point. It's like they've been good against left-handed pitching. Arizona, a tricky ballpark factor. Berríos normally would be the guy that I would feel very good about coming off a bad outing. I don't feel bad about him against the Twins. I mean, against the Mariners, but I feel better about Strasburg, even though it's against Lester's been very good.
Yeah, no, I can get behind that as well. Yeah, absolutely. And, right, and Washington's lineup's going to get a little bit better. We mentioned this on Friday's show with Turner getting back in the lineup. I think he'll start to score some runs now.
Now, where are you looking for offense in some of these evening games, too, when we're checking out the totals here? Do you think we're looking for, you know, you can stay on that Houston train, but it's super expensive right now. For me, I think it's the Padres. I think it's the – talked about it yesterday again. It's Franmil and Machado is trying to hit against the Pirate pitching, especially the underbelly there a little bit. I think that's a route to go. And I think Angels lineup is starting to wake up a little bit. I think the Ohtani injection there has been very good for them.
Oh, it has been very good. And they just went through a series against the Twins. Now, they lost 2 of 3, but they out-hit them in every game. I think they had like 17 hits in the final game of that series and lost 8-7. So Ohtani gets back in that lineup. LaStella's, whatever is going on with him, it doesn't matter. He's getting on base. He's leading off. And, yeah, the lineup has been better. And Junis is a guy we picked on all year. He's given up a lot of contact, a lot of home runs, a lot of fly balls. So I think that's the way to go potentially. And they're not expensive. Like, you're spending up on Trout, and that's basically it. Like, Simmons in that cleanup spot is dirt cheap on FanDuel. I think the Braves should be able to have success against Chase Anderson as well. There's obviously some expensive bats, but we mentioned Riley is a value play as one of the kids that's been called up and getting things done. And if you want to spend up, I think it's Arizona. I know it could be – it's maybe a little risky against Bumgarner, but guys like Marte and Escobar, these guys have hit lefties all year. They've crushed them, and good lefties, too.
Wilmer Flores is another guy who owes his left-handed pitching, too.
Absolutely. So, I mean, you get a couple of those guys in, and I think you're on your way.
All right, there you go. All right, let's move on to Sunday here in the 1 o'clock games. You got the Phillies and Rockies. Kyle Freeland and Eichhoff in this one. Eichhoff's pitched very well. You know, it's funny. Maybe this is just the weekend of trying the Phillies. Maybe it's just what we're at right now. And Freeland's
going to happen eventually.
It is. You know, and I mean, everyone wants to, you know, like, there's some good things happening. They're collectively pressing. And I think that's just only a matter of time. A couple dinks and doinks here and there, one big bomb, one big game, and all of a sudden I think everybody takes a deep breath and they get better. And plus, they've got a lot of new pieces.
They really
do. And just Segura, McCutcheon, Harper. It takes a long time for the new pieces to gel.
Realmuto, there's like five guys new in that lineup, and they've noticed the struggles, and they've just started to make changes to their lineup. Like, all year, it's been the same order basically all year. As good as Franco was at the start of the season, he was still hitting in that 8 spot. Like, it's just nothing has changed. And now recently, just a little minor switch. Move Harper up to the 2 spot, Segura to the 3. I think maybe you could spark the lineup. But now is the time to get in on them while everybody is not.
Yeah, I agree. I'm with you there. All right, so let's move on past the Phillies now and go to the next game here, which is we got Red Sox and Astros. We got Brad Peacock in this one. Boston still TBD. Now, I'm not sure exactly where they're at with the pitcher on Sunday, Rick, because they haven't even announced on MLB. So it's kind of tricky there with that one. But same thing goes. It's probably more offense than anything else. And it's probably both sides of the offense here, especially with Peacock out there too. I know Peacock is capable of striking some guys out, but he's limited in terms of how long he's going to pitch in that game. Charlie Morton, again, this is stacking up to be a tough weekend for the Yankees, where I wonder if all the Cinderella story of the Yankees offense kind of comes crushing down a little bit between Morton and Blake Snell. You know, yeah. I just kind of like,
oh, yeah. Those two are legit. Charlie Morton is legit. I mean, he was getting no respect again this season. Now he can't do it. He can't do it again. Double-digit K rate, you know, three straight years now. And I believe it's not official, Joe, but we could see Chris Sale against the Astros.
Well, that's what I was going to ask you. Is it going to be Sale? Because they haven't announced it yet. And if it is, then that changes the slate considerably. And I guess here's that question. How do you feel about Sale against this lineup in the Astros? If depending on what the discount is you get on Sale, I'm in on it.
Yeah, if it's like 10-2 or anything, got like 100 strikeouts.
Well, that's what I mean. He's striking out so many guys right now.
Yeah.
So whatever the whole wall, you know, I'm going to try to pace myself. Well, that's gone out the window.
Yeah, it's just completely gone out the window. And you fooled me.
And the Astros have been so red hot that I feel like there's got to be a letdown here at some point. And there's no bigger guy to lose that letdown to than Chris Sale. So if he is indeed the Sunday pitcher and you're getting any kind of discount just based off of how good that Astros team is, which I doubt you will. And I think people won't play it because they'll be concerned about how good that Astros line is. I wouldn't be concerned. Ty goes to the pitcher here for me without a doubt.
To me, I had slight concerns against Colorado and he destroyed them.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
It was unreal. So yeah, he's feeling it right now. And again, we've talked about this before. Sometimes that high price pitchers on the board, I think people will run to Syndergaard against Miami, which is fine. It's a good play. It's probably the best cash play.
It's but the chalkiest
to,
of it.
Yeah. If you want to pivot off that and be like, hey, you know what? I'm going to take Sale. You know, his price has dropped down a little bit. The ownership will drop down because he's up against the Astros. And we know that the ceiling is there with him.
I'd rather pay for Sale than Syndergaard in this one. I'm just putting that out there.
For and that same reason, the fact that you'll probably get him low owned.
I think the ownership will be lower on Sale because of the price and the matchup.
Yeah.
So I'm willing to try and go through. And it's because it's a Sunday too. Not only because of some of the younger talent, which we talked about on Friday's show, but also because you've got the opportunity here where you're getting a lot of those guys who don't usually play. They pop in on Sundays. You get the secondary catcher. You get all these things where, you know, there's a little bit more price flexibility on DraftKings especially. And then you got Ryu in this late in the afternoon too at 1 o'clock. So that's another guy who's been absolutely lights out. I'll tell you what, Ryu is probably my favorite of all these pitchers. He is having a Curt Schilling, Greg Maddux-esque sort of run here in terms of strikeout to walk ratio. That's just unbelievable. It's like 10-1.
He's phenomenal. He's been phenomenal and for a long time now. So and again, I said this on Friday's show with the Reds with Walker Buehler. So I definitely can get behind the root. There's some guys in that Reds lineup who have, you know, Suarez hits lefties well, but I mean, they just been underperforming and Ryu has just been so consistent. You're right. He's not walking anybody. He's striking guys out and he's getting offensive support. He's got defense behind him. I mean, if he can just put together a full season, can we see it? Can we see a full season from Ryu?
You know, the first 2 years he did. And there wasn't quite the strikeout rate or anything like that. And then he had a ton of injuries off and on, missing entire seasons. And then last year in the second half, the guy was just lights out. And I don't think a lot of people bought into it, or they were just too gun-shy this year to buy into it because of the injury history, which is fair from a season-long standpoint. And that's what makes DFS fun. It's like, you know what? You don't own Ryu anywhere? Well, guess what? You can own him every fifth day.
and I just brought up, I know this game's on the road, but I was looking at Ryu. So he's allowed 12 runs in his last 13 starts at home. That's 83 innings. He has 89 strikeouts over that span and six walks.
Walks. Crazy.
Crazy.
I told you. It's like the stuff you see from like Curt Schilling back in the day when he was like, you know, top of the line with the Phillies and then eventually with the Red Sox too. And just unbelievable. Bieber against Baltimore. How do you feel about this one? I know you love Bieber's strikeout rate, but I'm because of the other guys out there.
Yeah, Bieber he's been kind of frustrating and, you know, the strikeouts and the walks, but you know, he's been walking more guys than normal. He's given up some home runs already, 10 on the season. I can get behind him a little bit, but there's some other guys. I like here. I'd rather just maybe spend up. You know, we mentioned Morton.
I'll tell you the guy that I prefer. You know, I'm going to skip one of the 1 o'clocks and come back to it. But the guy I really like is Woodruff, who has pitched very well.
So good.
And Foltynewicz has not been good since he's been back. Let's be honest. Something's not right there. Atlanta better figure it out. They better
He might hit the IL again. If he has another bad start, I wouldn't be shocked if he just
100%, dude. 100%. Yeah. And Woodruff, to me, has pitched outstanding. That Brewers offense is going to back him up for sure. I know it's on the road, but that's not a bad thing for Woodruff too, because Milwaukee's a tough environment. So getting out of there, I'd rather have him on the road. But he's been one of kind of the quiet, unsung guys of that rotation, Woodruff. Strikeout rate's pretty good. I think everything points to him being one of the great tournament pitchers on Sunday, especially a secondary pitcher too with Sale, or if you want to do the chalky Syndergaard play, that's fine. If you're looking for offense, I think it's going back to Oakland. It's Oakland for me, It's going against Soto. And I'll tell you what, give me all the shares again, all the Davis, all the Olsen, just keep
playing. And they're cheap. They're cheap. Yeah. We mentioned it on Friday. They're cheap. There's only Chris Davis on Friday was over 4K on DK, and he's 4-1. We're always talking about values on FanDuel, and trying to find some values on DraftKings can be tough sometimes. And right now, there's value with the Oakland Athletics getting Olsen back in that lineup, playing in Detroit. The bullpen in Detroit has been awful all season long. Soto did not last very long in his last outing, and I don't expect him to again in this one. So I think it's a great call. And I love the Woodruff call as well. And for Folty, I mean, this guy is just taking a look now, Joe. 21 innings, 26 hits, 23 runs, 8 homers, 8 walks.
No, and I'll tell you what, that's why it's Brewers and it's A's. Those are the two offenses you want pieces of on Sunday. I don't care. You know, chalk it up, whatever. It's fine. Right is right. You don't get extra points for being fancy, kids.
No.
Just don't. You get points for being right, though.
Oh, yeah.
Keep that in mind. And, you know, and if you want to just stick to the cash, that's fine. I mean, we always like to say on the show here, with MLB, you want to play mostly cash games because that's just a much better format for the sport. Whereas NFL, it can really open up in terms of what you can do with that and tournaments and things like that nature. But you play cash games in MLB, you play them correctly, you're going to be consistently good, you know, 7 out of 10 times. That's winning. That's always going to be, you know, you in the black. Blue Jays and White Sox, you got Lopez and Thornton in this one. You know, Lopez is one of those guys, too, very frustrating because like, he has some games where he looks good, then again, where he doesn't look good. And to me, that's just not something either way I want to buy in on. So I'm going to take a hard pass on this game. But I don't know if you feel the same way. Do you think this is one of the sneakier games?
I think it could be. You're dead on about Lopez. He's just been so inconsistent. He's very sporadic. I mean, 4 walks per 9, but at the same time, 9.5K per 9. I mean, strikes guys. We saw the one performance against Detroit. Yeah, it was Detroit. He had 14K. Tigers strike out more than anybody. Well, the Jays are right there with the Tigers in terms of strikeout rate. So I don't love it. But, I mean, it's an option. It really is, because in that Jays lineup, there's just so many swing and misses. They don't have a ton of power in that lineup. So, I mean, we could see a line from Lopez where he goes 6-7 innings, racks up 7 or 8 Ks. If he can just limit the damage, maybe he can do enough for you. But it's all these other pitchers we've talked about are just – they're stronger options. It's just one of those, okay, I play multiple turnip lineups. I'm going to – you know, on FanDuel, you can't be your one pitcher. It's a DraftKings play only as your second guy.
All right. Now, in the afternoon slate, if you want to separate these out, you got Cardinals and Rangers. It's in Texas. Smiley's on the mound. You mentioned the Cardinals being this team that doesn't, you know, strike out a whole lot, makes a lot of good contact. I'm all in on the Cardinals in the afternoon. And I would like to separate these two from the early in the afternoon slate. I really would, because I would like to have Flaherty. Or if I don't have Flaherty in the Cardinals, just the Cardinals offense alone, because I think that this is a great opportunity here for them against Smiley in that ballpark.
Smiley, 57. I actually just like stuttered because it's so high.
I'm so excited.
57% hard hit rate, 57 and a 45%
fly ball. He's basically a batting tee.
Oh, he really is. I mean, he gave up 32 home runs the last time we saw him in 2016 with the Rays, 175 innings. And this year, he's given up 6 and 23. It's not a great environment for him. This is bad news for Smiley and the Rangers.
Now, the rest of the afternoon is a little wacky. You got Gibson and Kikuchi, the Mariners twins. You've got Musgrove, who was good his last outing. And I'm wondering if we're buying back against him, you know, against the Padres.
San Diego? I think you could.
I think you do. I think he's the tournament guy. I don't love Robbie Ray. You know, I love Robbie Ray moments. I had him last week and I got burned, He was okay. He was good enough.
That's all. It's just okay sometimes.
That's the thing. It's like, you know, even when he has the thing where it's all like just laid out there for him, he still doesn't quite.
Because he walks.
It's inefficiency. It's a 5-inning guy. And I think that's at the end of the day, even in the good ones. Then you got Danny Duffy against the Angels there. Now, here you go, Chris. We talked about the Angels.
Lefties.
Lefties. Is Danny Duffy in play for you on Sunday?
I think he is, yeah. I mean, yeah, we've talked about it all year. And, you know, he faced the Angels in his very first start. He went 5 innings. He didn't rack up a ton of strikeouts. Angels don't strike out a ton, but, you know, they weren't able to really do any damage against him. So I think there's an opportunity, but I feel stronger about Musgrove. I think you're onto something there. You know, he's coming off an encouraging start in Arizona. Only allowed the one hit. The Padres 27% strikeout rate. It's one of the highest in baseball, and it's a great environment for Musgrove as well. So I think that's the way I would go. Gibson's been really good this season, but he doesn't have a high strikeout rate either. So
well, that's the problem.
All the guys, it's Musgrove, I think.
Yeah, I think so too. That's why I like Flaherty so much, because he does have the strikeout potential. He that lineup with Odor and Gallo, as frightening as some of the bats might be at times, they do strike out.
They really do.
That's one for me where I think Flaherty and the Cardinals is the safe way to go. If you're looking for the secondary pitcher, it's Duffy or Musgrove. Don't get cute. I think Gibson's getting cute a little bit because you're right, the strikeout rate, and Ray's getting a little cute too. And San Francisco, as bad as they are, they're not a team that like you just looking for tons of strikeouts. They're just not good offensively. They make soft contact all over the place.
Yeah, they actually don't strike out a ton. No, they don't
not,
at all.
They're not terrible.
Yeah, they just – yeah, they can't. They don't have any power.
All right, so it's time to call our shot for the weekend, and I'm going to see if I can keep strong here. You know, I've talked so much about this offense all week, so I'm just going to go with it and continue on with the offense that I love all weekend, and that's the A's. So, yeah, maybe it's easy. Maybe I'm taking the easy way out. But, again, you don't get points for being cute. Well, maybe I do because I'm so damn
happy. I was going to say something like that. I was
That's right. Chris Davis goes yard this weekend. You got to lock that up. One of these games, if not both, he's going yard on Saturday or Sunday, or all of them, or multiple times because, well, he's Chris Davis. You see that's that too. Over the last 247 games, he's hit 247.
It's unbelievable. It really is.
Sometimes.
Oh, you really do. You get numbers like that, and it just, and, you know, it makes you smile. I mean, it's crazy. And yeah,
play Chris Davis
this weekend.
How about you?
I'm gonna go to, you know, you like Oakland so much this weekend. I agree. I like St. Louis a lot this weekend as well. I think I'll pick on Smiley on Sunday, and you can go any way you want, but I will go with Paul DeJong. We'll go with Paul DeJong.
I thought you were gonna go Ozuna.
I was actually. I was staring right at Ozuna.
And then you de-younged yourself. You went right off the bat there.
Book it. Carpenter, Goldschmidt, DeJong, Ozuna, Martinez. All of those guys will hit home runs this week. This weekend.
Well, who's your one? You got to pick one.
It's DeJong. I'm going DeJong.
DeJong's your one guy. Okay, that's the guy you're banking on. All right, you got 2 days to be right. I got 2 days to be right with Chris Davis. We'll see what happens here. Anything else from a betting standpoint that sticks out to you? You know, I'm thinking that the Brewers on Sunday are going to be the favorite, even though they're on the road.
They should be. They should be the favorite. I like that call. And if they're road dogs, I think you jump all over.
If they're road dogs, you jump all over that. I don't see how that's possible with the way Fulton Evich has pitched.
Yeah. I think the trend this weekend will be, you know, if you're taking some road teams because there's an opportunity, sometimes you get that, you know, potentially road dogs or, you know, the odds jump down a little bit because they're on the road. I think you can hammer Oakland all weekend. I think you can hammer St. Louis all weekend, at least the overs in those games. And I like the Dodgers on the road too. We're going to have Ryu and Bueller. I think there's an opportunity there as well. So those would be the bets. And the safest ones, I believe, would be the Mets. With Syndergaard heading into Miami, I think that's a solid one as well.
Yeah, definitely. So a lot of fun stuff out there for a good DFS weekend. The weather's supposed to be finally improving. That is also good. So hopefully the bank account will be improving as well. If you like the show, you can always subscribe to us wherever you listen to your podcast, iTunes, Stitcher, Google, what else? I don't know. There's a million of them now. I can't even keep track, Chris. There's so many places you can listen to podcasts.
Spotify, everywhere.
Spotify. I mean, we're everywhere. We're worldwide. That's right. Prestige worldwide right here. And, of course, big weekend, too. You got a lot going on. You got the end of Game of Thrones. You've got, I got NXT. I'm taking the kids to see NXT, a little bit of wrestling thing. So it's going to be a jam-packed weekend of sports entertainment, DFS, Major League Baseball, and, of course, Game of Thrones, which I am torn because I love the show. I'm excited to see the end. I am very sad to see it.
But you're sad.
Yes. Yeah. But you got to catch up.
I have been binge watching lately. So, I mean, I think maybe the next time we talk, maybe next weekend, I could be done.
Where are you?
What season are you into? I'm like five now. I'm midway through five. I'm just...
How'd you feel at the Red Wedding? Did you want to throw something or what?
Oh, my goodness. It's so intense. It might be one of the best moments, I think, of television history to me.
I had to pause it. And I was like, did I just see that? Yeah. Did that just happen?
Yes. It's right up there with, I was actually having a conversation with, and I know you're not into Breaking Bad yet. And I know
that's my summer. I know bad job on me. I've never seen Breaking Bad. I'm going to try that.
I was just talking about intense moments in television, just real moments, just And that was right up. There's two. It's that and Breaking Bad to me. There's a moment in that show where those two are just like, even just think about it now, goosebumps.
Yeah. Well, look, it's Thrones have been great. Don't believe the hype where everybody's unhappy with things for the sake of being unhappy.
Everyone's just sour.
Just, come on. Just, you know, life is short. Let's all enjoy things we can.
Agreed. You know?
And look, a perfect example, right? I'm a big Star Wars fan, always was. I'm not thrilled with the newer movies. I'm just not. I mean, I like the Rogue One. Not thrilled with the rest of the movies. I know we're going off track here, but whatever. It's the end of the show. We've already done all the baseball talk. But, you know, the last one was actually decent. I thought it was better than the Force Awakens. I thought Force Awakens
of
was
course, like, 100% better.
Force Awakens
yeah.
was like, I'm like, I've seen this movie already the first time. Like, you know, I don't know. It's very funny to me what people pick and choose to be upset about. And
yeah, people complain. It's a sensitive world out there. I think you said it at best. I mean, life is not long. You just got to, you know.
Yeah, enjoy greatness. Enjoy greatness. Like this show, like On Deck. Enjoy it while you have the chance. You can follow us at Lion Star App. You can follow us at Chris Meany. And you can follow me at Joe Pizzapia 17. That'll do it for us. Have a great weekend, everybody. There's only one thing left to do, and that is step out of the On Deck circle and into that batter's box and go yard. We'll see you next time, kids.
You've been listening to the DFS On Deck podcast, brought to you by Lion Star. Hit subscribe, tell a friend, and stay tuned for the next episode from fantasy baseball experts Joe Pizzapia and Chris Meany.